Welcome to Behind the Scenes of the Horniman Aquarium. My name's Michelle, I'm the Deputy Aquarium Curator here at the Horniman, and I'd like to talk to you today about corals. So I've been working with corals for about 12 years now, and I still have so much more to learn. So what do we think corals are? Do we think they're animals, plants, or rocks? What do you think? They're animals. The animal part of the coral is called a polyp, and it's sort of a squishy blob, and it's got tentacles around a centre mouth on top of the polyp. A little bit like the anemone in Finding Nemo. Polyps come in all shapes and sizes. They can live as colonies all together, or it can just be one big coral polyp on its own. And you can have soft and hard corals. We're going to be looking at hard corals. These are really branching, big corals that form the reef structure, like these ones behind me. So these corals are hard corals because they produce a coral skeleton. Much like the bone in your arm covered by your soft tissue, corals produce a coral skeleton. Here we have one here, and you can see here the branching structures that the polyps have built up, and it's covered in tiny holes where each of the polyps sits and will be connected together by tissue. Now, corals around the world are under threat. This is for many different reasons, from coastal development, overfishing, and then the big issues we face like global warming and coral bleaching. But we're going to hear a lot more about that later on. So you must be thinking, what can we be doing here at the Horniman to help corals? Well, we have built these specially designed coral, Project Coral research systems, and these control all the parameters of the coral system to replicate a natural reef. So we have an annual change, a yearly change in temperature. We have a change in light intensity from sunrise to sunset. And we even control the moonlight from a new moon to a full moon. Now these corals will only spawn and produce baby corals once a year out on the reef. And by controlling everything in our research systems, we have been able to get our corals to spawn. This is pretty amazing, and we are one of the first places in the world to predictably spawn these broadcast spawning corals in an aquarium setting. This footage is from our yearly coral spawns in the Project Coral research systems. Corals spawn at night, and here we can see the egg bundles leaving the mouth of the coral. You can see the tentacles really well here. The egg bundles float to the surface and separate and fertilize. The egg slowly divides and develop into swimming coral larvae. These then settle down on rock, or in our aquarium, on settlement plugs. The coral will then stick down and then slowly grow into an adult colony all of its own. This is my footage from our last spawn in January. In one day, 16 Acropora millipora, a type of branching coral, spawned, including corals that were born here at the Horniman. So we are going to have three generations of coral. That's the same as having a baby coral, a parent coral, and a grandparent coral. With this access to spawning corals and their juveniles, lots of research can be carried out into understanding more about corals and help restore corals in the wild. Now, we're very lucky to be joined by Dr. Adriana Humanes from Newcastle University, and she's going to be telling us about climate change and its effect on corals in the wild. So, over to you, Adriana.
Hi, my name is Adriana Humanes, and I'm a coral reef ecologist based at the Coral Assist Lab in Newcastle University. Our group, led by Dr. James Guest, is focused on finding ways to rehabilitate coral reefs that are vulnerable to the effects of climate change. As many of you might know, coral reefs are affected by local pressures like ocean pollution, coastal development, overfishing and fishing, and currently, the biggest threat that coral reefs are facing is climate change. During the last 30 years, coral cover worldwide has decreased by an estimated of 20%, and four pantropical coral bleaching events since 1983 have led coral declines on hundreds of reefs. So unless that we limit our future warming to 1.5 degrees, there are going to be very bad consequences for coral reefs, which have already experienced an average increase of 1 degree since the 1970s. Even if we can limit the warming to 1.5 degrees, it is highly likely that large areas of reefs are going to be experiencing regular bleaching events, threatening between 70 to 90% of the reef by 250. So corals are colonial animals that are formed by hundreds of polyps that are connected through their tissue. Inside their tissue, they have a microscopic algae that lives in symbiosis with the animal. When the temperature of the water increases, this partnership between the animal host and the algae is broken and the coral loses its algae. As a consequence, since the tissue of the coral is transparent and the skeleton underneath is white, the coral loses its color and turns white, a process that we know as bleaching. Bleached corals can survive for weeks without the algae, but after that, if they don't recover, if they cannot reabsorb the algae that are free living in the water, they would die. Massive bleaching events are usually followed by massive coral mortalities, where we lose the whole structure of the reef. During bleaching events, it has been observed that colonies can show differences in their heat tolerance, and some individuals are able to survive the heat stress event better than others. In this picture, we can see two coral colonies of the same species, one next to each other, being exposed to the same stress condition during the mass bleaching event of 2010 in the Caribbean, where one is completely bleached and died, while the other one is healthy and survived the stress event. So if coral heat stress tolerance is heritable, which is something that we're still investigating, then we could use sexual reproduction of corals with high heat tolerance to produce offspring to restore degraded populations or to increase their frequencies in areas that we have predicted that are going to be subjected to ocean heat waves. However, how do we know which coral colonies have higher heat tolerance without the occurrence of a heat wave? Our work is focused on developing a methodology to identify which are the most heat tolerant corals on the reef using aquarium heat stress trials. We do this by exposing fragments of colonies to a temperature profile that is similar to the one that have caused past bleaching events in the reef. We then bring the hardest corals into the lab to breed them together and rear their offspring in tanks and in ocean nurseries. At different stages in their life, we test the offspring to see if they have inherited this increased heat tolerance from their parents. Finally, we are outplanting these corals to the reef, and we're currently looking at ways to enhance their survivorship and growth in the wild until they become adults. Our fieldwork takes place in Palau with the support of the Palau International Coral Reef Center. The overall aim of our project is to see if this is possible and to develop a method to increase the tolerance of natural populations to marine heat waves caused by climate change. This knowledge will be of great use for rehabilitation initiatives of degraded reefs that aim to recover some of the ecosystem services and functions provided by coral reefs, and also to buy them some time to face climate change.
Thank you, Adriana, for taking the time to talk to us today. That was so interesting. And I hope you at home have enjoyed learning about corals with us today. Thank you for listening and enjoy the rest of your day.